Good evening, everyone. I, Avni Shinde, welcome you all for Ayur Samvad 2020's fifth session organized by Jigyasa Goa. Let us start the program by praying to God Dhanvantari. Namami Dhanvantari Madhidevam Sura Surai Vandita Pada Padmam Loke Jararu भयमृत्युनाशम् धातारमीशम् विविधौषधीनाम् चव्यामवाता वनिवारिबन्धिम् पञ्चप्रपञ्चात्मक देहभाजम् संताप संपात जराज्वरान्तकम् नमामि धन्वन्तरिमादिदेवम् नवीननीलमुदकान्तिकान्तम् शान्तम् हरैर्द्वादशमाख्यमूर्तिम् पूर्तिम् शतानां सुमनोरथानाम् नमामि धन्वन्तरि मादिदेवम्. Today we have with us Dr. Yogesh Bhendale sir. Sir is an Ayurvedic physician from India who has successfully treated patients of chronic and critical illnesses during his clinical practice of nearly two decades. He got his BAMS degree from Tilak Ayurved Mahavidyalaya, Pune in 1993. He got his MD in Rasa Shastra, that is Indian Electrochemistry and Ayurvedic Pharmaceutic in 1997. And he is a gold medalist from University of Pune. He is a member of American Society of Clinical Oncology and European Society of Medical Oncology. Dr. Bhendale offers special Ayurvedic consultations to patients in Germany, UK, France, Italy, Netherlands, USA, and Middle East, that is UAE and Saudi Arabia, apart from Indian patients. On his mission to propagate Ayurveda, Dr. Bhendale has traveled more than 1.8 million aeronautical miles around the world. His efforts have been acknowledged by ways of invitations from royal families and royal peers of UK, UAE, and Saudi Arabia. Besides, he was instrumental in setting up fully equipped 175-bedded Ayurved hospital in Germany in 1998, when Ayurveda was not so prominent in that country. Dr. Bhendale has collaborations for clinical practice and research in various countries. He is currently working with National Cancer Institute, USA, which is considered to be highest body of cancer research in the world. He is also involved in research with universities of Texas at Dallas, USA in Advanced Center for Treatment, Research and Education in Cancer, the National Center of All Sciences, Center for Materials of Electronic Technology. He is also an expert member of the General Body of Central Council of Research in Ayurvedic Sciences. His Rasayu Cancer Clinic is attracting cancer patients from across the globe. He started Ayurvedic Rasayani, which is his own pharmacy in Pune, with aim of manufacturing authentic Ayurvedic medicines. Dr. Bhendale also started a state-of-the-art research laboratory in Pune, conducting scientific search studies on Rasayan therapy. He has also invented a new anti-cancer molecule for which he holds patents for countries like USA, UAE, and India. He holds more than 50 other international patents. Two of his invented and globally patent drugs, which are NCEs for cancer and currently in advanced phases for clinical trials. Through his unique understanding of principles of Indian science of life, that is Ayurveda, and very effective command on its curative powers, Dr. Bindai has successfully treated patients with disease which have been termed as incurable by conventional sciences. Several patients with chronic and critical illnesses like advanced cancer, renal failure, liver failure, diabetes and its complications, cardiovascular diseases and hematological disorders have experienced the great healing power of Ayurveda and of under the guidance and treatment plans of Dr. Bindai. I welcome Dr. Bindai, sir, and I hand over the further session to Sunita.
Thank you, Avni. So let us begin with the session today. My question would be, why Rasa Shastra today?
Yes, in the first place, thank you so much for Sumita, Vaidya Sumita, and the earlier doctor who introduced me and the entire ABVP staff to conduct such a long web series for the all our colleagues and students of Ayurveda. So a small change or addition I would mention here about my introduction. We are not working with NCI actually. We are working as per the guidelines of NCI, which is National Cancer Institute in the United States. And we do have a lot of communication with them about our cases and yes, certainly we do have communication. So I don't know whether it is right to state whether we are working with NCI or not. That's why I want to make it clarifying. So our today's topic is Rasa Shastra, Tattva Shastra, and Vyavahar. So as we all know, and your first question comes as rightly pointed out, that why Rasa Shastra?
Yeah.
So as we know, Ayurveda is getting extremely popular, and though we are facing all over the world, we are facing a lot of challenges about COVID. But I would personally feel it is the best opportunity ever for Ayurveda as a project itself, as an extraordinary science. And this is where the Rasa Shastra comes in picture as a bold science. We all are aware that the government of India and the Ayush Ministry has published a couple of protocols and list of the medicines, which really contains, and rather precisely speaking, it is dominated by Rasa Shastra. So this is the, in short, this is a very legal answer that why Rasa Shastra. But on the other side, we all know that the importance of Rasa Shastra is Alpa Matra Prayogitvat Arutvera Prasangataha Kshipram Arogya Dayitvat. So we all must notice this word, that Kshipram Arogya Dayitvat. We are in a fast era today, and everybody, all patients are expecting fast results. It's not that it is a saying or a belief, and into bracket misbelief, that Ayurvedic medicines takes time to work
Yes.
in human. There is also belief in Vaidyas that Ayurvedic practice needs time to get it settled. So I don't think any new Vaidya has so much of time, so 5, 6, 7 years of waiting period to establish its practice. Neither a patient is, nowadays willing to take our medicines that will be helpful after 2, 3 months. So everybody needs immediate acting medicines, and the result should be seen in black and white. So, Kshipram Arogya Dayitvat, Aushadhibhyo Dhiko Rasaha. Aushadhibhyo means vanaspati ja aushadam. अधिको रसः. So there is something which is little more potent in Rasashastra, which gives faster results, which is entire expectation of the entire world from our community, and this is precisely the answer why Rasashastra. So I think it answers your question.
So my next question is, what do you think of this perception about Ayurveda?
This is a very intelligent question. As I already said that Ayurveda is being perceived as the slow acting science. But we have a very interesting reference about Ayurveda. Is you might have heard about that, yasya kasya taror mulam yena kenapi grishtam or sevityam yasmai kasmai pradatavyam yadva tadva bhishtam. So what is it means? I met at least a couple of hundreds of scientists, and you may call it as a key opinion leader, and the major sense about their talk is that we don't know how it works. We know that it works. So when you give some herb or some root with something to someone, something will happen. So this is the perception about Ayurveda in a society at large. So at the same time, today we must take this science ahead in such a manner that people will understand this is not only a great science, but it works instantly. And if you try to analyze it, you can analyze from the modern science, modern scientific language as well. I am well aware that not all the branches of modern medical science are evolved to the extent and to the level that it can explain Ayurveda. Because Ayurveda is also again a separate and distinct fundamental science, like physics, chemistry, biology. So physics cannot be explained in the language of chemistry and microbiology. Similarly, there is a possible debate that how can Ayurveda be explained in terms of modern medicine. I don't think that Ayurveda needs to be explained in modern medicine. But when any disease or any pathy has its own parameter of whether this disease is cured or whether this patient is benefited or not, irrespective of the diagnostic and the prognostic criteria, the result of Ayurvedic medicine should be very well established and explained. The result can be explained, not necessarily the science can be explained. This is a very important difference we must understand. So I think this is a major conflict and the major misunderstanding which needs to be clarified in the minds of students and vaidyas also, that we don't want to explain Ayurveda in terms of modern medicine, but we can explain the results of Ayurvedic medicine, which can be very easily analyzed with the modern medical parameter. So, I mean, this is quite possible, and we are using it since almost more than 25 years in our clinical practice. So, whether it answers your question?
Yes, sir. So we have heard that you have developed different treatment protocols for critical disease and chronic disease. Would you like to explain a bit on about treatment protocols?
Yes, actually, it's a big question, but I'll try to be quick. Basically, why we have developed these protocols? So there is a small story behind it. When I started my career, and it was about 6 months of the age of my practice, a lady came with a lot of whole body swelling, dyspnea on exertion, walking, small distance walking, dyspnea is there. We could see easily that this is a typical renal failure case. Of course, the result indicated that she is suffering from renal failure. She was having about more than 35 years history of diabetes, similar history of blood pressure. This is the main reason of renal failure. And her creatinine was around 7. And she was vomiting about more than 10 to 15 times, between 10 to 15 times per day. Loss of appetite completely, nausea. And she had been advised to undergo dialysis. And at that time, I was very young and we didn't have that much of experience of treating renal failure cases. But the only confidence is on Rasa Shastra, and we decided to treat this case. But at the same time, I was quite nervous also because she was in advanced stage and pre-comatose stage, having slurred speech. She came with her daughter, and her daughter explained everything in detail. So I gave her treatment for a week. And I told her, you please give me a call after 3 days. And I'm expecting your vomiting should be stopped within 3 days. So please call me after 3 days. And I was expecting the treatment. After 1 week, nobody called me. So I thought maybe, she was very reluctant to undergo dialysis, because she had a very bad experience in her family about dialysis. Her two sisters died on dialysis during the dialysis. She was having that mental trauma. And she decided that whatever happens, I can't go for dialysis. It was a very personal choice. And since she didn't show up for around the week, I thought maybe something happened that happened. Well, after a week's time, next day, she appeared in our clinic. So my first question, instead of asking how was he, I asked her that, why didn't you call me after 3 days? So she said that, you said the vomiting will stop within 3 days. So it stopped, so I didn't call. At least it was a positive remark, positive observation. And we continued her treatment. Around 6 months down the line, every week later on, every 2 weeks, she used to visit our clinic. She subsided all her symptoms. And being chronic diabetic and hypertensive patient, she used to visit her physician also. Around 6 months, or between 6 to 7 months, a strange thing happened, that her creatinine came down. It near to 2, and her doctor was explaining that when I was there in our routine visit to her physician, when I told him that I have taken Ayurvedic medicine for this, and her creatinine is getting down, nearing to normal now, and she is almost completely asymptomatic as far as renal failure signs are concerned. So how would it have happened? He asked the gentleman. So the answer was really given by a senior physician. It stunned me. He said, "Madam, sometimes it happens naturally." So this girl was a highly educated, qualified girl. She has a PhD, and she said, "But we have been told by multiple doctors, including you, that there was no other alternative than to go for dialysis or renal transplant." So we never knew that such patients can be cured naturally. So it was little friction between them. But when I get to know, I became little angry. And I requested the lady, "With your permission, can I talk to the physician?" She said, "Of course, why should I mind you? Please call him." So I called the gentleman and explained the whole story and his remark also. And he said, yes, there are certain cases where it can happen naturally. I said, "That's not the reason why I called you. My reason is, there are 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 pages books on nephrology. And in renal failure management, only two things are mentioned, that it can be managed conservatively to some extent, and then dialysis is the only option if patient is not willing to or eligible for transplant. So just add a single line that there are cases that this disease can be cured naturally." So it was a little, naturally, he didn't talk nicely, he banged the phone. But that gave us a lot of learning, and it changed really the perspective of our approach towards Ayurveda's clinical practice. Of course, I learned with a lot of Vaidyas, the major impact is of Vaidya Kolhatkar sir from Pune, and Kolhatkar sir brought me to Vaidya Kolhatkar sir brought me to Vaidya Prashant Nagavadikar, and both of them were having their own system of treatment. I was fortunate to have both of them. Nagavadikar sir used to believe in doing investigations. This was the experience of our patient. So I decided that we should develop a system that will help not only our own practice, but coming generation, and why not to set up as a protocol. So that's the major and basic protocol what we have designed.
Okay.
So I explained about the objective of the protocol. Why? I mean, the story behind the protocol. So now, why these protocols, or what are the objectives of these protocols are? This is very, very important to know. And we are Ayurvedic physicians. We are extremely passionate and having extreme faith in our science. But we cannot impose our faith or our passion on our patients. We can't take them granted. So we have to develop a certain methodology which has a rationale. And the first thing is that we can't take granted that our medicines are always safe. We will come to that point later. But we can't take it granted, because the world wants the safety assessment of your medicines. You cannot say that Ayurveda is 5,000 year old science and we are using it every now and then. We have thousands and millions of cases who consume these medicines. We are in scientific era, okay? And we want to talk a very hardcore scientific language, and precisely a global language. So our first objective is to assess the safety as well as efficacy of Ayurvedic management. Second important thing is unbiased critical assessment. I should not say that my patient is benefiting. In the first place, patient should say, and even more importantly, anybody who can assess this patient should confirm that this patient is improved or cured. So we should be open for critical assessment, and that should be unbiased. Third objective is rational path for global understanding. Because this is the global language what we are talking about. So it's very difficult to work with Rasa Shastra on a global scale or global platform. Because modern medicine, and most of the time it is seen that Ayurvedic medicines do contain metals, and it may be hazardous to human health. There are reports published, publications also. That's not the part of discussion today, but how irrational, unscientific, and unscientifically designed study-based publications still published in one of the most reputed journals, that's the irony of today's science as well, are published. So we have accepted. So let's follow the rational path. And we never faced any difficulty in taking Rasa Shastra at global level. We cannot think that we know Ayurveda means we know everything. Ayurveda is such a vast science, even we know 0.001%. Still our life will be, you know, useful for the mankind. So we need to have the learning approach every now and then. So the another objective towards this protocol is our own learning with critical assessment. The next point about this is evidence-based protocol, which increases the confidence of our own self and the confidence of our own vaidyas and our own community and the scientists working together. Another important thing is social awareness on a modern scientific background. This is very, very important. Social awareness with modern understanding is the need of an hour, and that's the language we must talk about. And that is what we are doing. If we follow this, this is always very easily acceptable to patients and also caregivers also. So these are the certain protocols and the objectives of the protocol we have designed. And now when we come to the clinical practice, the application of this protocol, how it goes. Because this protocol has been developed not by my own understanding and what I think appropriate, it's not the origin of this protocol. But the origin of this protocol is how my patient will get confident, how my colleagues will get confident, how my entire fraternity will get confident, and how my science Ayurveda will be established all over the world as a highly commendable health science. So this is the main objective behind the rationale of this protocol. Many of the times when I keep talking with a lot of students or vaidyas, I realize that there is a lot of fear. It's a great fear factor about the Ayurvedic medicines or the Rasa Shastra medicines specifically. And how can we build confidence within society? So these protocols are designed taking these multiple factors into consideration. So when any patient visits our clinic, we take detailed Ayurvedic case history at first consultation. Details. Ashtavida Pariksha, Dashavida Pariksha, whatever clinical science, whatever the diet history, etc. So we generally don't keep any stone unturned. Then we do baseline investigation. So what is this baseline investigation is doing in Ayurvedic first visit? Very important. I would like to request all of you to listen this very carefully. Approximately 5 to 7% of the cases we have seen or we are treating routinely. Unfortunately or fortunately, we are dealing with only those cases who have been left out with modern medical science, unmet medical challenges cases, because that's the area we have selected. Everybody has its own liberty to select their own areas of working in Ayurveda. So we have decided that we will work only in critical illnesses, chronic illnesses, where society has no other option. So when we do the baseline investigation, about 5 to 7% of cases show little above average of vital organ safety parameters. Creatinine 1.5 is above normal. Sometimes patient comes with 1.7, 1.8, 2.1 at the first consultation. Bilirubin 1.5, 1.7, 1.9, 2. Liver enzymes got up 70, 80, 100, 150, something like that. Urine may show urine protein, albumin urea or protein urea. Blood count, simple blood count, complete blood count, CBC, may show either anemia or platelets are low. So some or the other ailments are very easily seen. So my friends, now imagine a story that when you treat anybody without doing these investigations, and after 2 months, this patient visits to some other system of medicine doctor, and if he does these reports and found that creatinine has gone to 1.7 instead of 1.5, or hemoglobin has come down, then unfortunately many of the times Ayurveda is being blamed. You are taking Ayurvedic medicines, though this would have happened because of Ayurveda. So always remember that a person is not blamed, Ayurveda is blamed. Rather, it is better to be blamed, to blame a person. But it's very bad that Ayurveda as a science is being blamed. So it becomes my extreme and pertinent responsibility that I should secure my science in today's era, in today's language. And this is the main reason why we do baseline investigations. And we do these investigations in national accredited board labs only, because we don't want any small question also to be raised on our science. Then every 2 weeks, the clinical evaluation is being done as per Ayurvedic guidelines. Certain patient-specific tests are also done, ECG, X-ray, etc. Every 2 months, the above blood test, CBC, LFT, RFT, also we are doing. And in terms of cancer, we do the PET scan or HRCT or any other radiological assessment which are important to establish the efficacy of our therapy. So this is in short the protocol what we have designed. And n number of Vaidyas are using this protocol in India and with successful efficacy is apparent.
So you prescribe Rasa Aushadhis in cancer patient. So I would like to know, what is the role of Rasayan Chikitsa in cancer patient? How it works?
We all know I don't want to enter into any theoretical part, frankly speaking. We do have a lot of cancer patients. I accidentally and incidentally entered in oncology. It was not planned at all. But first success started, and then mouth-to-mouth publicity, and then now we have a separate cancer clinic. So when we try to understand what cancer is, so we thought that how can we, you know, because cancer is not explained in Ayurveda, even though we try to fit cancer in Ayurveda, I don't think that we'll be able to fit cancer as such, apple to apple in Ayurveda. I don't think. Many of the times it is considered as Arbud is cancer, it's very simple. Granthi may be considered as cancer. Any growth can be considered as cancer. Cancer itself has got, you know, modern medicine. It's of course a great medicine, and they categorically talk. They talk very, very specifically and precisely. So when they say that this is cancer, there is no vague approach, no vagueness. Except certain tumors are not well differentiated. So barring those very, very low percentage of exception. So I think that the body or the sharir is very well explained by our science. And the word sharir, shiryate tat shariram. I am proud to say that the definition of body or sharir, I don't think anybody else than Ayurveda has been defined it better than Ayurveda. So shiryate tat shariram. What degenerates is body. So we all know that utpatti, sthiti and lay. This is the srishti niyam, siddhanta. And we are part of nature. So we also have to follow this, you know. So we take birth, we live, we grow, we age, and we die. Same thing happens to the cells. Cell, it takes birth, it leaves its lifespan, and it dies. So I think the best part of Ayurveda, which is closer to this disturbed cell cycle rhythm, is Rasayana. So when people think that we treat cancer, we never say that we treat cancer. We never say, because that's not Ayurveda ideally. We treat individual. We treat human beings as a whole. Because cancer, even though there is a tumor in the liver, it doesn't mean that only liver is affected and the whole body is absolutely clean. It never happens. Our science explains it very well. But modern science approach is very reductionist approach. They talk about cancer only and treat cancer only. We talk about whole body and we always treat the whole body. And we found that Rasayana's approach is the best approach in treating cancer. We started treating Rasayana, the cancer patients, with Rasayana therapy and started using potent Ayurvedic medicines. And we realized that not only patients started becoming better clinically, we have a number of studies which are validated on global parameters, and patients are living without cancer in their body very happily, and long life they have achieved as compared to the expected survival of that particular cancer. So I mean, you can choose rasayana depending on a patient and a disease. So we have multiple rasayanas for liver cancer, there is different for colon cancer, breast cancer, neurological cancers are there. So we diagnose it, we understand what and dhatus are involved, and then we design these rasayanas, and then we prescribe. And we assess it as per the safety norm, as per the protocol, and whether the tumor has shrunk or tumor has grown up, as per the PET scan, which is the latest technique to actually assess the tumor. So this is how the correlation between the scans. There is a lot to say about rasayana. There is a different chapter. We have identified the 20 points of rasayanas, how these rasayanas are being formed, in the 20 properties and the positions, and we can share the application of these rasayanas. There are 20 in human body. So that's not our today.
So what would you comment on Rasashastra manufacturing and its Rasaushadhi manufacturing and its importance? Like how we have Shodhan, Maran, Charan in Rasaushadhi manufacturing. Are there any advancements done?
Yes.
Or any other technologies used?
Right. It's extremely important question in today's era. Because we are not ideally taking Ayurveda as it is expected for our ancestors also. Because it is supposed that it is expected that every Vaidya should prepare its own medicine. But for some or the other good, bad reasons, it is not possible. So we fairly dependent on industry to get this medicine. That's one hard reality. On the other side, patient comes with a critical disease with great faith in you, the person. And when we use a tool, that's a medicine, which you don't know how it is being made. You don't know its characteristics. You don't know the processes that will do. How will you build a confidence in that? And if you don't have a confidence in the tool, how will you give the confidence to patient? And if there is lack of confidence in medicine, even though we are having great confidence in understanding of a disease, finally what is going to work inside the human body is medicine, what we give. We are not talking about the earth dravya, we are talking about the dravya. And I think this is a big challenge, and I am sure that our entire strategy should be very well aware of this challenge. And if we don't improve on this, I'm sure that we are not going to show the miraculous results of Ayurveda in society today. It will be a very mediocre time. And that is what not expected for us also. This is the main reason we manufacture our own medicines with extreme care, but most importance is given. When we prepare Hirak Bhasma, we don't prepare it below 200 putar. When we prepare Swarna Bhasma, we don't prepare below Shataputi. We don't use any Bhasma prepared below Shataputi Bhasma. But then only you can expect and command great results, what is needed for society. So I don't think there should be any compromise expected at manufacturing. How industry works, that's a different scenario. That's not a part of the discussion today. But I must say that we have to be extremely cautious about what we are using, and we should have extremely confident about our selection of medicine. Yeah. Yeah. Any question?
So, could you mention about some successfully treated cases by using rasaushadhu, like in pediatrics, hemological disease, renal disorders?
Yeah, sure. We have a very recent case in pediatrics. A child with the age of 4 months, if I'm not wrong, suffering from biliary atresia. And the child has been asked to undergo liver transplant. The doctor advised the better survival of transplant after 1 year. The challenge is how to let this child survive till 1 year. Because when he visited our clinic, he is absolutely like we have applied turmeric on entire body. Icterus is that much. Bilirubin was 16 plus. Liver enzymes elevated. Unable to eat, of course. Also, 4 months baby, shattered parents, and it was the first case, honestly, because this is a very, very rare disease. And they visited us after the Kasai procedure. They already went through, and it failed. So the challenge was, in the first place, to let the child survive for a year. And then maybe it can be taken to liver transplant. That was the first challenge. So a small baby, how many times he can take medicines? So these are practical challenges. So, your questions, I know your questions are very intelligent, and our talk is based on Rasa Shastra, Tattva Shastra, and Vyavahar. So this is Vyavahar, that patient is visiting to your clinic. You have to demonstrate the science based on certain tattva. So the tattva what we discussed earlier, that Alpa Matra Upayogita. Matra is very minimum. At the same time, Kshipram Arogya Daitya. It should act fast. So this is my science. If I believe in this science, it should work. So we started with literally 5 milligrams of medicine. You can't even see, 5 milligrams is very little matra to the baby. And the another interesting thing what we have done, we started treating the mother and asked mother to keep breastfeeding the child. So we have given adult doses to mother. We have developed certain rasayana called, we call it as Dasma Rasayana. Dasma Rasayana is the Somnathi Tamra mixed with Hira. Very potent and very extraordinary combination. We are using largely in liver disorders, liver cirrhosis, and multiple cancers also successfully. Very interesting combination. I will explain, if time permits, the tattva behind the design of Dasma Rasayana. So gradually the baby started getting more appetite, After 1 month, the bilirubin started little going down. After 1 year of the treatment, not only the baby survived for 1 year, after 1 year, and now this baby is a boy. Boy, 1 year plus boy, bilirubin is around 1.5. All the liver enzymes are normal, and now he is not in need of liver transplant. So can we use Rasashastra in pediatrics and even in such cases? It's strange because unfortunately the poor couple didn't have any option. They couldn't afford liver transplant. 40-50 lakhs rupees is the average cost. And our country cannot afford this. Majority of people in our country can't afford this. So this is the science. And we have kept every month regular reports of this child. And this is how we have seen that the graph of improved graph of this child. So there are multiple cases. I do remember another girl, and she was a school going girl suffering from myelodysplastic syndrome, and she used to undergo blood transfusion every 2 weeks, something like that. It's an old story, more than 10 years back. And her father was a poor man, I think, driving rickshaw or something like that, and can't afford blood transfusion once, twice or thrice in a month. And they have been asked to go for bone marrow transplant. Same story, they couldn't afford. So the only option left was to keep on giving blood transfusion. We started Hirak Rasayan, other Rasayanas, other medicines including Ayurvedic, Aarogyavardhini, Pravah, and those medicines we have started. Gradually the distance between, the interval between two blood transfusions has increased, and the time came that the girl didn't require the blood transfusion for about now almost more than 8 or 9, 10 years. The girl is absolutely cured with myelodysplastic syndrome. It is incurable hematological disorder. So this is one, about the pediatric case. We do have n number of pediatric cases also to improve the immunity of children, because now every child is taking frequently antibiotics, and because of low immunity. And we all know that Ayurveda is proving to be the best solution to improve immunity, even in children. They reduce the antibiotic need and they recover well, and so on. So there are multiple stories like that. Your pertinent question about the renal diseases, I already shared you one case about renal. Yes. We do have multiple cases in each area. I can share a very interesting case of a very old gentleman, because Rasashastra can be used in pediatrics and Rasashastra can be used successfully in geriatrics also. When he started his treatment, he is one of the most eminent personality in nature scientists in India. He has written a couple of encyclopedia. I can't reveal the name on ethical purpose. But when we started treating him, he has been referred by another big person to us, and he lost his eyes because of diabetic retinopathy. He couldn't see properly. And because of that, almost 16 to 18 hours busy person, when his eyes are challenged, he naturally entered into depression. And then he tried, obviously, earlier treatment. What are the conventional therapies like laser treatment? All those have been already taken care. And unfortunately, he became refractory to available therapy. He visited our clinic. We started our treatment. Within a week's time, he started seeing a little better. The dark clouds, dark threads coming in front of his eyes started reducing. After 2 weeks, his vision is little improved. Within 1 month, in his own language, he has improved his vision more than 60%. Today, it's more than 6 years. He is around 84, if I'm not wrong. Still working 16 to 18 hours a day. 4 years back, Nagpur University has offered him DILIT, which is an honorable degree, for his contribution. And he is absolutely working without any disturbance in his eye. We haven't treated his diabetic retinopathy alone. When we started his treatment, he was borderline renal failure patient. He was having chronic cardiac ailment. He has been advised that he may require bypass or angioplasty. Around 7 years later, he is still on our medicine, taking our medicine with no toxicity, no CBC, skipping of RBCs, etc., no raised liver enzymes, no renal parameters have been deranged. On the contrary, everything is improved than before, and his eyes are also improved. So in geriatrics with multiple complications in one patient, with Rasayana and Rasashastra, he is living absolutely fantastic life without any compromised vital life. So this is, I mean, there are hundreds and hundreds of stories I can share with you. I can tell you only last interesting case, because today we are in COVID era.
Yeah.
So whether Ayurvedic people can treat COVID or not, that debate was over before. Now everybody can treat COVID. But this is the case when it was under extreme debate. The patient was in ICU, already exhausted all lines of therapies available at that time. Consumed a lot of steroids, exhausted all courses of remdesivir, favipiravir has been also used, n number of scientific antibiotics given intravenously, exhausted. He was on ventilator with no hope. Somebody referred this case, a gentleman in the middle, that there are no hopes, then can Ayurveda be useful? Now we must understand that a patient is on ventilator and how can we administer Ayurvedic medicines? So it was a big challenge in front of us all. So I talked at a length with doctors at ICU, who is ICU in charge. It is one of the biggest hospitals in Pune. So I get to know, and he said, doctor, there is no hope in this case. We have tried everything and we are just expecting that when we can remove ventilator, then the relatives will tell us it's right. I said, doctor sir, please don't remove ventilator, let it go, how it's going on. But I have one request, that if possible, can you reduce these medicines which you are giving? Anyway, you say that these medicines are not working. So what is the point in continuing these medicines? With great faith, that he said, he agreed to this. very unusual, very, very unusual. So if major medicines were stopped, which were from modern medicine, conventional medicine, then we started our medicine. Obviously, our medicines are rasayanas given sublingually with the least doses. And gradually, patients, relatives have been advised to report us every day on a daily basis. We kept on monitoring the urine output, input ratio, heart ratio, pulse rate, everything is monitored. FiO2 is being monitored, D-dimer, CRP, ferritin, IL-6, everything has been critically monitored. Gradually, the patient started showing some responses in the requirement of NORAD injection, which is needed for ventilator support patients. So when the need of this injection is reduced, the dose is reduced, it means that the patient started responding on its own. This patient was in ICU for 3 months on ventilator. After our therapy, he was on ventilator, I think about a month, because it took a lot of time. Then the tracheostomy was done, then weaning process has been started. And now the patient is at home with no oxygen requirement. We are able to let him walk gradually with small distance without dyspnea. And this is complete survival with our treatment, with rasayana, with rasachar. This is one case I am sharing with you. We do have a lot of cases in ICU about COVID. And I am sure that Ayurveda and Rasa Shastra is a great hope. Not hope now, because we do have, and I am sure that a lot of Ayurvedic Vaidyas have successfully treated COVID. But unfortunately or fortunately, we have decided to work only in critical cases. So we are more interested in only COVID cases which are not, you know, refractory, which are refractory and not responding to modern therapy. They have exhausted the available therapy. So we are dealing with only left out cases, and these are the success stories of Rasa Shastra and latest story about COVID. And I mean, there are many more about it. So, I mean, it's been such interesting to have this dialogue keep on going and going, but I'm sure there is a limitation of time and you may have the questions from public also. So I think I should, over to you.
Yes, sir. So there is one question from the comment section. Specific medicines for COVID thrombosis. Any experiences you can share?
Very good question. We have developed certain protocols for COVID. Age-wise, comorbidity-wise, here the main question is, what is being called as comorbidity? Generally, it is seen that the known allopathic disease is considered as comorbidity. Diabetes, liver disease, heart ailments. We have come across n number of cases which do not have comorbidities, but led to serious stage. After detailed history, we get to know that these cases were suffering from either chest, anxiety, acidic disorder, acidity, pittavikruti. So these patients are more susceptible to get completed. This particular question about tambaku, we do have success stories of removal of thrombus from a very particular and precise vein for an artery, especially renal vein, renal artery thrombosis. When we treat the diabetic retinopathy, there is a bleeding. After that, there is thrombosis. Still, there is a clarity in vision. To our best knowledge, we need two important medicines in thrombosis. Apart from the other specialty medicines like Aarogyavardhini, Proathinchambu, but the main medicine for this particular state, we give Hiraldasna once a day, 12.5 milligrams in capsicum, that is 1/10 of a gram. And as I said, that we have developed a rasayan called Dasna Rasayan. This Dasna Rasayan contains Somnathi Tamra Dasna and Hirak Dasna again together. This has a very specific Vamitya towards the blood vessel. And this is Somnathi Tamra Dasna has its own characteristics. And we have seen that we have used in multiple cases and we didn't come across any complicated case so far.
Thank you so much, sir. We were very fortunate to have you today as a speaker, in spite of your busy schedule. You managed to speak at our webinar. Thank you so much, sir. On the behalf of Jigyasa Goa and Abiriti Goa, I would like to thank you, sir, as well as all our attendees of the today's webinar.
I must thank you all for patient listening. And in fact, if there is any useful information you might have received, I would be happy and I look forward that your generation will take Ayurveda at much greater heights with great confidence. This is what why I firmly believe in all of you young guys.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I would also like to express a great sense of gratitude towards all those who helped us in making this event full. Last thing I would like to say, please stay connected with us through Jigyasa platform for more updates. Uttishtata Jagrata Prapya Varani Bodhata. Arise, awake, and not to stop till your goal is reached. Thank you.
Thank you, Sumita ji.
Thank you, sir.